Oh, we could put the Sako thing in the intro if we decide on a location now.
Oh, is that how we're starting this episode? Well, I'm scratching my back. We don't know what the episode, the location for the Sako thing is.
Yeah, let's choose one.
What, in front of them?
Yes.
Welcome to the 119th episode of the Carmudgeon Show. My name is Jason Cammisa. This is Derek Tam-Scott, and we are part of the Hagerty Podcast Network.
No, our show is...
And this is part of the Hagerty Podcast Network. Today, we're talking about not our Sako episode, because we still haven't... Sako car show.
Correct.
Because we haven't bothered to pick a location.
We're talking about handling. Yeah. Cars have it. Some more than others.
Yeah, that's it. We're done.
Sure. I guess...
Embarrass ourselves. Thank you. Don't make it awkward.
Just because that one was so shitty.
Okay, Derek.
Okay, Jason.
Smell this. Something I don't usually say to people.
Yeah, I have an older brother. I've learned to never come smell this. It smells like Griot's leather cleaner.
Actually, yes, but also Meguiar's 40. No, Mother's number 40, which is the interior cleaner. This is, so the folks at Hagerty's gear department sent us a vintage leather seats scented candle. Huh. But every time I smell it, and I love it, but every time I smell it, I'm like, number 40? Like, number 40 is my interior detailer that I always use. So funny. It's probably the same active ingredient as Griot's, because Griot smells the same.
It says to keep it away from children and pets, especially while burning.
Oh, well, do we have a lighter in here? We have no children or pets. I don't know. It's super cool. I think it's a good looking candle.
I like that smell.
Well, we're going to be smelling lots of it.
But don't, I would say as an insurance company, Hagerty probably would recommend against burning it inside of your car.
Well, your car should already smell that way.
Yes. But sometimes, you know, it needs a little pick me up.
Yeah, no, please do not light this in front of it. Does it say not to light in the car?
No. It just says please don't. Children and pets. I think it's a standard candle.
Please do not light in the presence of a running fuel pump.
Yeah.
So we have a topic today to discuss, and it's handling.
Handling. Not handling. Like George Frederick Handel, the Baroque composer. No.
If it's before the disco era, I don't understand.
Before the disco era. Disco classical.
That's not true. Before Motown. Nothing before. Oh, no. Jazz standards. Mm. How far back can we go in our music catalog? Okay, handling. Please define handling, because this seems to be a non-universal definition.
Yeah, that's a question that I, as we discussed, actually we didn't really discuss, we purposely didn't discuss this topic before so that we could have the discussion now. That's us not doing research.
No, that's allowing us to fight in real time.
I think this is going to be like competence versus, obedience.
Competence versus obedience.
One of them is the car executing your wishes. The other one is like, how capable is it, right? You could say some car is really competent, but like it's a knife edge car at the limit where you're just like, we're going to die or go really fast. Mm. Like the Lancia Stratos, right? Is that one of the best handling cars of all time? It's very fast, but it's also terrifying. Like, does that discount it from being one of the best handling cars of all time, or is it just the most something else-est car of all time? You know, so like, could a mid-engined car be the best handling car of all time if it's like the limit behavior is periodic death backwards Carrera GT?
Death backwards, yeah.
You know, like I would argue maybe Carrera GT is not the best handling car of all time, or couldn't even be considered an objectively good handling car if... Or you could just say, I lack talent. That's the other thing you'd say. Like, who is the person who is making the car handle? Is it a very talented, lightning fast reflex professional operator? Or is it some schmuck with a right foot? You know?
With a right foot?
Period? Well, you know, that's your... Yeah. Your
I thought you were going to expand that. Your intonation said right foot and a limp. Or, I tend... You didn't actually state something. You asked another question. But I think we are both probably going to be in agreement that handling is not really about capability as much as it is does the car follow the intentions of the driver? And to that point, maybe Carrera GT, which I've not driven at above the limit, is really a good handling car. But if the driver asks it to kill them, it does.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yes, which could be like the 9/11 thing. And then the question is like, who is the person who is judging handlingness? Is it some person who, you know, doesn't have a lot of experience and is just like, I want to go fast point to point in this car on this road, you know, in which case you'd say like something with four wheel drive and, you know, a lot of suspension travel and really grippy tires and, you know, a reasonable blend of compliance and control or whatever could be the answer. But if it's like a Randy Pobst or a, you know, then the answer is maybe different.
I always go back to the cover of the Hagerty magazine, that this cover story that and a video actually also that my boss's boss did. Larry Webster did a Meet Your Heroes question of, was the Corvair actually all that bad handling? And will this car kill you?
Is this the one that involved the Tatra?
Well, yes. Somebody did roll a Tatra, but this it wasn't part of that video. That was Sam Smith who rolled the poor Tatra. And that was, I think, more a tire inflation error than anything else. But the point...
Isn't that what people always say when they hit crowds of people in M4s leaving cars and coffee?
Well, what just happened? Like... Did I pop the tire?
No, but that's a tire temperature issue. No, this one you could clearly see the tire was tucking under. I mean, it was a swing axle car and tire was tucking under. We'll also have pictures of this, but the tire was tucked under so far that it caught the car and rolled it. But Larry did some really stupid shit in that Corvair, and it was fine. It didn't try to kill him. Now, swing axles are such that they do tend to force the car to roll over, and that's part of the problem. But the oversteer that car was crucified for having actually did not seem to bother Larry at all. Larry's a hell of a driver, you know, but I don't think that's the Widowmaker in any more than a 911 is a Widowmaker.
Which is considered generally to be a Widowmaker. Yeah,
but I don't think they are.
What,
I mean,
911s?
I've never had a 911 bite. Almost never have a 911 bite me. Biting me is code for did something that I didn't ask it to do or punished me for a mistake in an unforgiving
disproportionate way. Yes, but and those cars have a bad reputation because there is a talent issue with the people who own them. You know, 930s have a widow-making reputation, particularly because the engine is so unresponsive and in one regime and so responsive in the other regime. And if you happen to transition between those two regimes while the car is not pointed straight, then it'll spin. And so people are like, nothing's happening. And they're just jamming, stamping on the throttle while going around a corner and then boost hits. Then you're going to go into orbit. Early 911s maybe can be a little tricky with a shorter wheelbase and worse weight distribution and skinny rear tires. You might have a little more sketchiness with an early one, but my experience with those cars is that they will do what you ask them to do. And if you request something stupid,
it's going to do
it. Garbage in, garbage out.
So I often have described my Cosworth Mercedes 190 as the best handling sedan I've ever driven. And that it's, although I don't think I said it the best handling, it's the best balanced sedan.
Yes.
So for me overall, I'm not really looking at overall capability. So when you're talking about, I'm not talking about grip level. I'm talking about what happens when you exceed the grip level of the car. In the case of that Causey, of the Mercedes, it just doesn't understeer. At any reasonable speed, it's not going to understeer. You get right to the limit of adhesion of the front tires and maybe 1% after they'll let go, 1 or 2% before the back starts to let go. And you can modulate that so easily with throttle.
Moving weight forward and aft, that changes the relative grip of the front and back of the car. And so you can choose your destiny.
You choose the attitude. Handling attitude, right? It's anywhere between a little bit of understeer and full tails out opposite lock stupidity. And it's one of the best balanced cars I've ever experienced on a racetrack. It's also not the best handling car because you do have to drive around certain things, right? It has a monumental amount of body roll, especially compared to modern sports cars. So it's very softly sprung. There's a lot of body motions.
There's also the steering.
And the steering is relatively slow. I mean, it's faster than any 30 M3, but it's still relatively slow.
That's not a high bar.
No. But, you know, and you also have an issue, which you wouldn't think necessarily has to do with handling, but does, of the very, very progressive throttle that does almost nothing until you're at the halfway point. Mercedes has done this historically to allow you to be a smoother driver.
With the notable exception of the C43.
Yeah.
That car is calibrated. You put your foot in, you just hit the gas with your toe, and it's like, rah! And it's like, the thing feels very peppy, which is an interesting trick. It's the same thing that Subaru does to mask the fact that their cars have no guts.
Almost all modern cars do that. But, you know, back in that day, Mercedes did it the opposite way to you know, help you be smooth. So the adding power in the measure that you want to can be a little bit tricky. You have to drive around that throttle calibration. You have to drive around some of the body roll. But ultimately, the balance is perfect.
And the steering wheel size.
Yeah. But I'm not looking at, when I say that, like, you know, cars handles well, I'm not talking about pulls 1.27G on the skid pad, because there have been plenty of cars that I've driven that pull a tremendous amount of G on the skid pad, including the camera van, which we mentioned last week on a Michelin Pilot All Season 4s.
You mean next week?
No, last week.
Last week? Oh, okay. Sorry.
Some time ago slash in the future, I mentioned the fact
that... On a different type of episode.
The minivan, the Chrysler minivan that I have on Pilot Sport All Season 4s outgrips the base, not the base, the GT Performance Mustang on its P0s. But does that mean the van handles well? Absolutely not. It's wretched. It's terrible. It falls into hideous understeer. The entire front end goes mushy. The car is just kind of flexing all around. But it's got the grip. Probably pulls the G or close to it. And so the reason I brought this up, and I wanted to do an episode on handling, is I made a statement while we were in the company of a couple of stunt and race car drivers that created a lot of
controversy.
Discourse.
Yeah, discourse. Sure.
I said I've now driven the best handling car I've ever driven in my life, and it was a Lucid Air Sapphire.
Which weighs?
As much as a planet. A large, heavy, lead-filled planet. Mm-hmm. 52, 53, 5400 pounds. And so...
Okay, let's just have you say that statement again.
The 5,000 plus pound Lucid Air Sapphire is the best handling car in the history of the world, period. And I've really thought a lot about saying that because it's quite a statement.
It is.
But let me define why. Okay. So the Sapphire has two rear electric motors. So it's three motors total, one on the front axle with an open diff and two on the rear without a diff. So each side has fully independent control over that motor. So you could, for example, have 600 horsepower on one rear wheel and minus 600 horsepower, i.e. 600
this
horsepower.
This is the Rimac's trick.
Exactly.
Although they do it with four motors.
They do it with four motors.
Could the Rimac's unseat the Lucid? Given what we know about the folks there and what you experienced with that car, you did not drive that car at the limit.
It was raining.
It was raining on a leaf-covered public road.
Because of that car, my actual statement on, I think it was Instagram, was the best handling four-door car, whatever, because there is the possibility that the Rimac Nevera would outdo this
with
car.
With four motors.
It all comes down to tuning, right? Mm-hmm. NSX, that the last hybrid NSX, had torque vectoring in the front on a mid-engined car, and that should have been the best handling car of all time because there's the recipe. There's everything you need, but which wasn't tuned properly. Okay, so Lucid, the regular Air, which I've given that ridiculously glowing review to on the Icons episode, is 1,111 horsepower. That's the limit effectively of the batteries and the motors-ish together. Each motor can deliver about 600 horsepower, and the battery can deliver about 1,200 horsepower. So they called it 1,111. There it is. This now has three motors that can each deliver 600 horsepower. The battery can't deliver much more than that. It's basically the same. So that's, but they've rated
than the 1,200?
Than the 1,111 horsepower car.
Yes, okay.
So this is 1,234 as its rated output. 1,234 is effectively the limit of the battery and the power electronics. But you can take that 1,234 and apply it any way you want, up to 600 at each wheel or rear wheel, or 600 to the front. Mm-hmm. Your throttle pedal, your accelerator pedal, is a request for power from the battery, effectively. So think about it that way. You could be requesting zero power, but have a total of 800 horsepower being deployed, for example, because one of those rear motors might be generating 200 horsepower, while the other one is pushing out 600. So you have a net of 400 plus another 400 from the front motor, right? You just don't know. I think I fucked that up, but you know what I mean? Like the total number is what you're requesting, but how it gets that power to the ground is completely up to the powertrain computers. And what I experienced in that car is unlike any other car. So when I say it's the best handling, it's because it 100% followed all of the driver's intent. So everything I asked it to do, it did in the measure I asked it to do in it without hesitation, and then without biting me when I asked it to do something that maybe I didn't mean to ask it to. So coming around a corner, the car starts as you're turning if you're turning slowly and gradually into the slightest little bit of understeer, and then stays there permanently. And this is in track mode with everything on. There's kind of not much you can do sort of on the way into a corner to help the car over rotate and thus have to make a correction. If you're asking it to turn in smoothly, it goes right into the limit at a 1 or 1.2 out of 10 on the understeer scale. And then your throttle application will start to rotate the car a little bit. With everything turned fully off, it goes into a very different mode. This isn't just now I'm going to allow wheel spin and slippage. It now changes the attitude of the car completely. And it's ass first at all times. It's so ass first that it's definitely slower around a racetrack, at least with me driving, than it would be in track mode, because now you're managing the rear the entire time. Mm-hmm. But what happened was I did the way this was supposed to work. I'm sorry for hijacking this whole section of the episode, but we'll come back to you. We're supposed to do a warm-up lap behind Ben Collins, the Stig. He was in a Grand Touring Performance, which is 11 horsepower, two motors, and much, much less aggressive tires and suspension calibration. We're supposed to do a warm-up lap behind him around Sonoma Raceway, and then he would do a hot lap as fast as you could keep up with him. And then a second hot lap where if you flashed him, he would pull over and let you pass, because if you thought you'd be able to outdrive him. And then a cool down lap. I made it to turn 5, which is the carousel, on the warm up lap, and he pointed me right by. And that's not me. I'm not faster than the Stig. That's the difference in performance and speed between the Grand Touring Performance, which is basically the dream that I did the original video on, and this new car. I was at 5/10 and he was sideways scrambling, trying to get the fuck out of my way as fast as he could and get his hand out the window in the middle of a slide. It was pretty impressive. By the end of that first corner past that, I never saw him again. I mean, it's that much faster. And so the first lap I did was really still a warm up, and I was in track mode, which is, you know, that little tiny understeer mode. And the car so did every single thing that I asked it to do, that I wound up driving effectively 10/10 around Sonoma Raceway, which walls.
You don't do.
You don't do. I've won a Lemons race at that track, but you're never really flat out in there's a couple sections where the cost of making a mistake is so high. Yes. Because there are so many walls and you're going to hit them so quickly.
Yeah. I've seen people medevaced out of there before.
Almost everyone I know who's raced there has left in an ambulance or a medevac and has lost a car. And indeed, even the Lucid guys started out the whole safety briefing with, it was David Lickfold, who's the head of the chassis tuning. He was like, we like to think we know what we're doing. I've written off my personal car here. He's written off his personal car here. She wrote off her personal car here. I mean, he went down the list, and all of the geniuses who tune that chassis have written off their own cars there. And it's just the way that track is. Mm-hmm. But by the end of that first warm-up lap, I was sliding to within an inch of the track out, hitting every apex just like a complete, like I was in 100 horsepower Mazda Miata. It was just spectacular, but the car did everything I wanted, except I wanted to feel what everything was like with it off. So on the front straight, going into my should have been my first actual hot lap, I turned everything off. And then I proceeded to do a 10 and a half tenths slight drifting lap around this track, a track that I don't drive Miatas at 10 tenths in because I'm so scared of. It did fucking everything. Anything I wanted it to do. If you tried to get it understeer, it'll understeer. But you got to ask it for. You got to ask it to do so. And then you got to fight it to stop from going back to neutral because it wants to be four-wheel drift everywhere you go. And little things. Like I came in, there's a back straight. We did the chicane setup. So there's a back straight with a 90 right and a 90 left. And I came in, the braking markers were ridiculous because cars get 1,200 horsepower. So we're driving it in endurance mode, which brings power down to 800-ish, whatever the fuck it is. And it's still so fast that your brain can't process what the hell's happening. And so I'm like, braking marker, my ass, every time. And you know, the markers that they had set up were accurate. So I came in for the chicane like 15 miles an hour too fast. 15's a big speed to come in too fast.
Yes.
But this is the slowest part of the track. It's a 90 right, 90 left, and there's dirt. And I could, you know, the car's, it's not a, it's not an open wheel car. You can just go straight over the dirt. I thought, eh, whatever. So I'm coming in and I'm under ABS and I realize very quickly, like, whoopsie, didn't knock off enough speed. So I just thought, let me just see what happens. And when a car is under ABS, it's difficult to get them to move and change, right? The ABS will preserve some of the steering, but you're, the available tricks that you have to change the car's attitude are pretty slim. Right, and you're gonna just throw the car sideways. You're gonna spin it. You're just gonna upset it in all these different ways. So I said, "What the fuck?" And I Scandi flicked it in. So Scandi have flicked it. Flick a quick left to the quick flick to the left, and then a big right steering input just to see what it would do. And it did a perfect Scandi flick drift, still under ABS, all the way with not full lock, but as much lock as I could give on to the left, still under braking. And I realized, holy shit, I'm going to make the fucking corner. But just getting the car sideways, scrubbed off that much speed. Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to hit the apex. And it's not my talent doing this at all. So all I did was give it a dab of gas, flick it the other way, and then said, holy shit, the car in the middle of an ABS slide did a 180. And then I turned it into a glorious four-wheel power slide that I was almost full opposite lock to the right coming out of the out of this hairpin with a wall 20 feet to either side of me laughing at the amount of smoke coming off of these tires. No one, you don't do that at Sonoma. That's not supposed to happen. So when I say that this is the best handling car I've ever driven, it's because it did things that are not possible.
Superhuman.
Right. And when it did it, when I fucked up, it allowed me to unfuck it up by violating the laws of physics because it has the hand of God hovering over it with torque factory. So my next question for you is, because it's all computer controlled, does that mean it's not a good handling car?
Well, let's see. You asked the car to do something that was based on your desires, and the car did it. So
one
it's
way
not
or another.
It's yeah. not it's not nothing. It's not based on nothing. It's not completely synthetic. The experience that you asked for was a thing that every driver hopes that a car would do, but no car actually would do. Yeah. So it's not completely contrived. It's not something that's made up out of nothing.
Because I struggle with this, right? I mean, okay, all modern cars, all of the best handling modern sophisticated cars have computer interventions that you don't know or feel. The best examples are GM's, what I call the Dyna Magic, right? Dynamic yeah. Magic, where, for example, on a CTSV or ATSV was one of the best examples. You'd start to be on a track and you would add more steering and you'd get to the understeer limit. And you know that you're at the understeer limit because the front tires are singing, but also you start to add a little bit more lock and the amount of
turning
yaw doesn't increase, right? But you add a little bit more steering and all of a sudden the back starts to come around. And you can't do that. Like, you're changing the front wheel steering. How the fuck did the back end of the car respond? I don't know how they're doing it. GM admits they do that. They are not going to tell me or anyone else what their special sauce is.
Well, it has to be
is.
Something at the back end.
Something's going on at the back end. Or with roll stabilization. The car has magnetorheological dampers. So it can change damping at all four corners independently, which effectively can change roll stiffness. It can play with the diff by unlocking and unlocking. It can do all these little
tricks. It can individually
brake
wheels.
Yep. And it's happening in the background such that you don't even know it exists, but you know that's not possible, but it does it anyway. And so I started thinking, I'm like, is there actual demerit point for Lucid or for GM or for any other, Porsche does this too, any other manufacturer. Porsche just plays with engine mounts,
yeah.
Right? You can stiffen up or loosen the engine mounts in the 991s and 992s, it happens as you're driving, to smooth things out and change the attitude of the car. Is it cheating?
I don't know. I mean, you're getting where you're trying to go. I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question.
There is no answer. I mean, I personally don't think so, because I didn't point a wheel and say, get me there as fast as possible, and it got me around the track. It did what I asked it to do, which is now...
Even if what you asked it to do would just historically be considered impossible.
Right.
But you would also say to someone who is making an internal combustion car, if you had the ability to deploy power to every corner of this car... in the measure that you want,
independently,
would you do that?
Of course.
And every engineer would be like, absolutely, I would do that. You know, and that's what most of the things that cars do are aimed at creating one way or another, whether it's a limited slip differential or traction control or whatever. The fact of the matter is that with an EV, you have a lot more precision and control and flexibility and leeway to create that outcome. Yep. And so an engineer who's designing the car, even if you could go back to 1919 and ask the person designing the first Bentley ever, if you had that ability to do that, would you check that box? And the engineer would be like, absolutely, yeah. I'm interested.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in that sense, it's not discontinuous or not consistent with the spirit of, you know, anything. Everyone has always been pushing the limits of the technology given the era, I think.
Fair enough. Okay.
So I would say that most of those engineers would, if you asked of the hairy chestedest of the old school Cobra, you know, pre-war, whatever the fuck, if they could do that, they would be interested.
Okay. I'm just curious on your take as a 94-year-old. I mean, 95 now, whatever.
I mean, the question that this comes back to is what happens in the real world? How entertained are you? How much of a good time are you having with this car on a B road? You know, because it's the best handling car ever, does that mean it's the most fun or joyful car that you would choose to go on a back road with?
So annoyingly, because of traffic conditions, I feel like this chair is sinking, by the way. I keep getting lower and lower.
Your magnetorheological shocks.
My magnetorheological chair is failing and your light is off. So we're just a disaster today. You've got two lamp on.
All right, chaos.
Because of timing of the whole situation, I wound up doing a set of large drifts and donuts and burnouts in the car. And that destroyed the tires. So the guys had to change it. And by the time they changed it, sorry, Lucid, we hit massive traffic. So I was not able to do the back road.
The donuts were mandatory. They could not be avoided.
The donuts were a request by me. Could somebody please take my iPhone and take one video of me doing this so I can use a freeze frame as the thumbnail for this episode? So I went and did one big, huge slide with the sun behind it to backlit the sun. And then
the smoke.
The smoke. And then I was asked to do it again by Lucid because their drone
enthusiasts
didn't get it. Well, no, because they're nuts, right? They're ones of us. But they asked me to do it and hopped in the car with me. But their drone hadn't gotten it and their professional photographer was still running over going, oh my God, what the hell am I missing? So we got... some really cool shots of it. And I got to destroy four tires in minute and a half. But anyway, their traffic was such that on the road, we couldn't really get a chance to go crazy on it. I did have Jason Fenske from engineering explaining the car with me. And with him in the car at a...
Did you hit his head on the B pillar again?
No, I tried, but it didn't work. 65% state of charge. On this. So, you know, like when we do testing on EVs, we always make sure it's over 95% state of charge to start with, over 90 for the whole test. We precondition the battery. We do everything we can. I had Jason in the car, 65% state of charge, no preconditioning, air conditioning blasting, and it pulled off a 1.98 second 0 to 60. So to answer your question, is the car fun in the real world? No, that's not fun. That's nauseating, and that's the fastest way to get your passenger to punch you in the dick. But
what about back roading?
I didn't do it, but I did do it on the regular air, and that car has really precise steering, beautiful body control, and all of the other things.
Communication? From the steering?
We're not talking 911 GT3 997 levels of steering communication, but we are talking end of the run Jaguar hydraulic steering levels of talkativeness.
Okay. All right.
It's not, I'm trying to think who makes the best e-pass at the moment right now. And Lucid's up there. It's up there with GT cars. There's a little bit more slop
meaning
in the system.
Meaning Porsche GT.
Yeah. A little bit more slop in the system. It's a luxury car. It's a little bit more isolated.
Can you imagine if they made a car that was in the form factor of a sports car?
If Lucid did?
Yeah.
I can't. I can't. I mean, these guys, the guys and girls, that team is, I almost cried. Like I genuinely got out of the car and walked right over to David and just held up my hand and said, congratulations. Like there's nothing to bitch about. There was a couple things to bitch about, but I told him later once, but it was just such a moment of like, how the hell did you make this car that knows what I want so well that I trust it to fling it sideways, aiming at a wall, and it's your $300,000 car, and there are other journalists here, and everyone's going to kill me if I wrck this thing. And whatever. Just didn't even I was so comfortable in that car that it didn't even occur to me to woe it down. Didn't have to, because the car did everything I asked it to do. Mm-hmm. And that is so not the case in so many other cars. You're always driving around something.
Yeah. So philosophical question. Mm-hmm. They knew this would resonate with journalists who can turn a wheel. Does their demographic care?
God, I hope so. I mean, look, I had dinner with all the Lucid people, and I had Peter Rawlinson next to me, who's the CEO, and he's just one of us. I mean, that, you know, that he's ex-Lotus. Everyone is sort of, you know, everyone's resume is pretty impressive on this team. They're all sort of ex-Tesla also. And Peter's like, you know, there's a 600 horsepower motors. We could put the 670 horsepower motors in there. And I'm like, stop it. Stop it. You've proven it. You've done it. I'm so thrilled that you guys have shown the world that an electric sedan can be the best handling car you could possibly drive. Maybe except for a Rimac, right? But I need you to fucking put an SUV in production and get that shit out the door to
start
make
printing money.
Right. Start printing money so that you can show us what you can really do. Because I don't want the Air Sapphire to be a one-off. I can't afford a $250,000 luxury sedan, nor do I really want one. But what I do want is imagine like a 3-motor hot hatch with a total of 600 horsepower that can fucking drive like this. There's my new track car. Forget about the e-golf.
Your everything
car. It's my everything car. It would do it all. And I want Lucid to survive long enough to make me a $60,000 hot hatch. So please put the fucking pens down and stop with the fast shit. The car is literally perfect in dynamics. They need to move on to mass market stuff. And I really hope they
high profit margin.
High profit margin stuff. Because I'm sorry. Mercedes engineered like no other. Fuck you.
That was true in the 90s.
Yes. And Mercedes EQS. So it was, we had a great dinner. Actually, it was a bunch of really senior seasoned journalists at the table. Plus Ben Collins was there. Plus, you know, CEO was there and a bunch of great opinionated people. And we all agreed that the top three worst consumer products right now in the automotive space are Mercedes EQS. Not in first place. So third place was Volkswagen ID4. Second place was Mercedes EQS. And those who had driven it gave first place to the VinFast. But the fact that this little startup with a bunch of guys and girls who were just dicking around, car people who are just dicking around and having a good time, can make a car that not only is not on that top list of three, right? That includes VinFast, but can make a car that so comprehensively shits on every one of the established best players in the business is barely conceivable to me. It is, the EQS is not a well executed car. And you know, I'm a Mercedes fan and Mercedes is going to listen to this and ban me from all their cars. Mercedes is incredible at making some of the best cars in the world. And that EQS is just not, doesn't play to any of their strengths. When you say engineered like no other, when you say Mercedes-Benz, Lucid's Air does S-Class better than S-Class does.
Yes.
When you say Porsche, there is no substitute, right? Porsche is the best dynamics of any mass
any segment
market.
That they're in, they dominate dynamically.
For the most part, yeah. Especially the GT cars. This shits so comprehensively on the Taycan that it's just not even fair. I mean, you have Taycan Turbo S is the same price as this car. It's got twice the fucking interior space 500x better steering feel. And the Turbo S is spectacular at the limit, but it's just not a good car. It doesn't have any packaging. It doesn't drive. It's not particularly fun in any way, or it's just not what I want out of a Porsche. Then you take Lotus, right? Lotus has the Eletre, that SUV, which, wow, okay, that was really fast and impressed us with a gorgeous interior, but it's not packaged like this. Lotus's DNA is simplify and add lightness. Okay, lightness is dead right now because we're in a period of time in the automotive industry where lightness doesn't matter because it's just not possible with batteries as they are. But simplify, this car is the same size as a 5 Series on the outside with the interior space of a 7 Series and more room in the rear trunk than either of those cars, plus then a frunk big enough for me to fit in. It's this. You compare that to a Taycan that has no frunk, no backseat room. You can't get in and out of it. You can't see it. Like, it's got the Lotus thing, the simplify and just add lightness in the way the car feels thing down better than anything Lotus does. So you just start going through the whole list of like the heavy hitters in the automotive industry, and Lucid, this startup with a bunch of lunatics, has just outdone all of these heroes. And that's why I almost cried. I'm like, oh my God, this thing is genuinely game changing. And anyone who says an EV is boring and soulless needs to drive a fucking Sapphire on a track. Your mind's blown. There's nothing comes close, except maybe Rimac, another startup, because they're all using torque vectoring and EVs.
We are experiencing a seismic shift in automobiling.
Yeah. The
companies that were startups when the automobile was invented are now the incumbents.
They're dinosaurs. And they're acting like it. I mean, even Bosch. Think about the amount of contributions that Bosch has made to all of us. Would half of us be here if it weren't for Bosch with ABS and stability control? Think of how many times your ass has been saved by a Bosch invention. Forward collision warning, whatever the fuck it is, right? Bosch's ABS works at maybe 25 hertz. Lucid's works at 1,000. Lucid's.
So do they use suppliers for anything?
No. So the Sapphire is the regular Air uses Bosch ABS and Bosch traction control. So they do a little bit of traction at the motor, but most of it's done by Bosch, and it's at 25 hertz. The in-house traction and stability control works at 1,000 hertz. 1,000. I think we've talked about this before, but 1,000 hertz means that each of those three motors, independently of one another, could go from plus 600 horsepower to minus 600 horsepower and back 500 times a second, which would be enough to shatter the drive shaft instantly. I mean, there's nothing, no CV joint is ever going to deal with that. It would go bam and explode. So they have to, it's so fast that they have to actually smooth and sort of dither everything down. Mm-hmm. That's Bosch. What are you doing? What are you doing? Like, what the fuck?
They are not used to dealing with powertrains that have that capability, and a gasoline engine can't do that. So why would they engineer something that operates at that level of frequency?
Yeah, okay, but look, when did the Porsche 918 Spyder get an electric front motor? I mean,
yes, okay, historically that has been true. Yes, but now we're coming up on 10 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
your Model S is 12 years old. Why the fuck is no one caught up to this? Right, it's the Rimac and the Lucids that are catching up, and the VWs and the Mercedes, the two of the best car manufacturers in the history of the world that are getting so left behind. Mm-hmm. Staggering. And by the way, in terms of the sort of Lotus thing, Sapphire doesn't even have magneto-rheological shocks.
What?
No.
Doesn't need them.
Doesn't need them. Rides like a dream.
Maybe that's why they never call it
a dream. No. No. And when I talk to the engineers about that, they're like, no, there's too much friction. The latest generation of MR dampers apparently doesn't have that, but the seals in the piston, this is how they explained it to me, I'm not a shock guy, but the seals that they need in the piston to contain that MR fluid have to be so thick and robust that it actually adds stiction and kills ride quality. So they just went with a different solution. And so here's a car that doesn't need some of the benefits of MR shocks, where you can tighten up one corner and loosen another one to start to rotate the car.
You can do that with the powertrain instead.
And by the way, torque vectoring, the best way to think of it is a wheelchair. Right? Wheelchair doesn't have a steering wheel. The front wheels can go whatever way they want, but you're steering the car with the rear wheels. Push forward one on the right, backwards on the left, and you're turning to the left. And this is exactly that same thing, that ability managed 600 times a second, Mm-hmm. Or 1,000, I'm sorry, with 600 horsepower on at your disposal on either side, managed 1,000 times a second plus the same upfront. Nuts.
Yeah.
Just, it can't. We can't.
Physics defying.
You're never going to beat that with internal combustion anything.
So is this the future of joyful motoring as we head into EVs? Is that this technology makes its way into enthusiast packaged cars instead of luxury form factors?
Can you imagine a
price factor
like GTI? Oh my God. Yeah. I don't know.
That's an exciting prospect. But you have to be the thing about, not everyone is a handling person. You don't live in a place where handling matters, or you don't have the talent or experience to do that. It took, you know, years of motoring before I sort of reached the point where I really got the handling thing and stopped paying so much attention to the more sort of accessible characteristics of a car, which is just powertrain, right? And a good engine, you don't need any level of skill or experience to appreciate a really magical mm-hmm. engine. And handling does take a little bit of cojones and experience and a good road
mm-hmm.
where
or track
to extract that value from a car. And so this mm-hmm. that initial like sort of lightning strike of joy that you get out of as soon as you start a car and it has a really evocative idle, you know, mm-hmm. in a big V8 American car, like that is going to not exist, but it's going to have this other thing that requires you to be a little more dynamic in order to access.
Yeah, I think you're right. Do I think any EV is going to take the place of some of the world's best magnificent internal combustion engine manual transmission cars? No. It's a different game.
Yes, right? But there is something joyful to behold in the future that exists opposed to just this sort of like, fuck it, we're all done.
Yeah, the future isn't going to suck. I mean, again, 1.98 second on fucking at a stop sign to 60 with a passenger and AC and all that. I mean, that's the best time that anyone recorded in Tesla on a Model S Plaid on a prepped surface. These things were doing 1.8 to 60 on a prepped surface. That's just nuts. 8.9 something in the quarter mile on a prep surface, 9 flat on the road. Like, this is just insanely fast. And to combine that with the handling ability that it does is just, that's never something we've not seen before, maybe outside of Rimac, which you and I haven't driven on track. But it, you know, in the real world, are they as entertaining? No, nothing is going to be as entertaining. But what you're looking for below the handling limit is a connection to the road. Right. That's mm-hmm. why we've bitched ever since, you know, the year of the flood about the death of hydro steering, is because you're missing that intimate connection with what the front wheels are doing. And at least Lucid is one of the companies that's concentrating on that driving experience, not the Nürburgring. They haven't talked about Nürburgring lap time, although I can't imagine any sedan is going to keep up with that thing. You know, they're not really. The sort of drag race portion of the our driving experience was like, here you go. Okay, you did a 9.03, you did a 9.02, you bid an 8.95. Goodbye. Next, now let's really go drive the thing. Because the straight line speed becomes a one-trick pony, obviously, sure, and this car is not. So, you know, they are concerned with how things feel and what the ride quality is really like in different circumstances. And I think that's important because we're at the end of where it's, soon it won't matter if the cars are driving themselves, limit handling is going to become irrelevant. We've talked about this. You know, you don't want your Uber to be limit handling you to the airport.
I'm interested to see AI or the autonomous cars doing that, though. I feel like it could be pretty entertaining.
Drifting stuff? Oh, yeah.
Against each other, mm-hmm. sort of interacting with each other.
Yeah.
That'd be fun. It'd be amusing.
We should invent a new holiday. National Drift Day, where all the autonomous cars just can be sideways on the roads everywhere they go.
It's like watching
a
horse race a little bit. Or no, it's like watching a dog race because there's no jockey.
That's true. That'd be fun to watch. Or just the one day a year. Like, you know, if you take your Uber today, it's going to be limit. Like no speed limits apply. They just drive as fast as they possibly can, as fast as the AI will let them not crash.
I'm awesome. Interested to see that because that's never what you see the autonomous vehicles doing. It's never about speed from here to there.
Yeah, it'd be awesome if it was. It'd be so awesome. I mean, can you imagine? That's one of the real benefits of autonomous driving is we should not have speed limits for all that much longer. Mm. Like, there's no reason an autonomous car should have a speed limit.
Yeah, but the humans should.
Humans should?
Yeah.
Okay, trained humans shouldn't. Yes. Well, Germany. But yes. Yeah, like I just did that I-5 slog down from LA to San Francisco again. It's just 400 miles of fucking misery.
Misery. I freaking hate that drive.
You know, it's just, everyone is in the wrong goddamn lane.
And it's only a two-lane road, and there's a whole bunch of trucks, which like cause miles-long situations where there's one motherfucker in the left lane going 2 miles an hour faster than a truck.
0.2. Yeah. It takes them a half an hour to complete a fucking pass.
Yeah.
And then when they finally do, there's some schmuck in a Prius going 0.02 miles an hour faster than that. And so you can't get past them for another fucking half a mile. It's maddening.
Yeah.
And I just keep thinking, this is all the failure of no driver training and incompetent, inattentive boobs at the wheel.
Yep. All of that is true.
Yeah. So give me a car that can do fucking 180 miles an hour on that road in a convoy with six other cars. And I'm not taking a nap. It'll be great.
Yeah.
But yeah. Handling is a very misunderstood thing because, you know, I used to, as a kid, when I used to read Car and Driver from start to finish, it was, you know, let me look at the skid pad number. Okay, that's one number, but I've driven plenty of cars that are able to grip well, but handle like shit.
And vice versa. Don't have much grip, but just the way they behave at their low limit is just like...
Alpha 105.
Yeah.
For example.
My Giulietta was like that.
Yeah.
Even though it's from the late 50s and...
It got a little bit of demerit points because it had no brakes because they were drums.
The harder you push, the more you slow down. It has brakes. People reveled in period also at how good the brakes were in that car.
Okay, in that period, yeah. But I mean, I think also braking, the ability to brake easily and modulate your brakes and have them not overheat is also part of this whole
thing. Well, they don't overheat. They just don't have much ultimate capacity, retardation ability.
All right, what's the best handling car in your opinion?
I don't know. I mean, it comes back to definitions. I find it difficult to argue with 911s because they have so much flexibility. There are so many different ways to drive that car, which means that if you want to engineer as the driver some outcome, there is a reasonable chance you could do it. You know, the car can be made to be neutral, it can be made to understeer, it can obviously be made to oversteer, which is what everyone always talks about. And so I like the fact that that car gives you a lot of arrows in your quiver for how you can get from here to there in what attitude. Mm-hmm. You know, cars that won't do anything other than, you know, understeer or whatever, like obviously that is a big demerit. So I think for me personally, I'm also very comfortable in those cars. 911 is a strong contender just because you have so many options and the throttle does so much too.
Right. I would agree with you. And I'd say I don't think all 911s are created equal. If you understand that, we've talked about that, I've joked about this before, that 911's handling book has, you know, 15 appendices and it's 1200 page, six volumes of rules. But all of those things that it asks of you, if you understand its language, it will do anything you want it to do, nearly.
Yes.
When it bites you, it can bite you pretty hard, but the new stuff isn't that way. So, like, you know,
this is why professionals, racers, like, are so unstoppable in those cars. Not only do you have all of these sort of options for how you can drive the car, but they're also durable and well-engineered and intended to survive for 24 hours, you know, flat out or nearly flat out.
Yeah. And I see front-engine front-wheel drive cars are at the sort of other.
There's a lot of tools, not available.
Right. Or actually even worse, fixed all-wheel drive system cars like Audis tend to be even worse because there's nothing you can do. The car's just going to do what it wants. You have no tricks in your arsenal. Then become front-wheel drive, then front-engine, rear drive. Mid-engine cars can really be all over the place.
Yeah, quite variable. And that sudden departure thing.
Mid-engine cars don't... Yeah, they don't like to slide in a lot of cases. And so, and also typically as they warm up, they'll go from being neutral to understeery as the front tires get hot. And they're just not, I don't think I've ever found a mid-engine car that's as consistent lap after lap after lap after a 911 is. Cause I think of where the weight is on the 911. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I would have to say that like 911 GT cars are about as perfect as it could get. A lot of GM stuff is really close.
Yeah,
a lot of Ferrari stuff is really close. Computer controlled, you don't notice it. Mm-hmm. Turn it all off, and the car is unmanageable. But straight out of the box, it's gonna be a 911. So, interesting experience.
I'm brought to tears. I am super interested to try one, and I'm super interested for them to prosper, for Lucid to prosper, and produce a whole bunch of other products that eventually end up with some device for the enthusiast. That's you know, in reach, which today in this day and age means under $100,000.
Either that or the whole team just gets hired by BMW, fixes that company from start to finish.
BMW is so bass-ackwards, they would never have the vision to do that.
I hope every chassis engineer from that fucking company drives a Sapphire and realizes that they could have been there. They should have been there, and they should have done this first. Porsche too. I mean, Porsche, you know, I can't complain about the Taycan's handling, but sorry, different league. Mm-hmm. Yeah, interesting. Interesting times to be an enthusiast, for sure.
Much to the, I don't know, disagreement of all the people who are like, I will never EV, just, okay, fine.
I get it. They've never driven one. That's
a good one, especially.
Yeah, and I
begrudgingly find myself liking them as a 94-year-old, obviously.
Yeah, you can't come away. I'm very curious to read the reviews from the other journalists who've driven that car. But I was just, I'm sorry, there's just gobsmacked. No contest. There's just, this is the next chapter of vehicle dynamics. And Rimac, we should talk to Rimac and see if we can get a track test of that car. But has anyone done that? Have you seen anyone do like a real handling?
I mean, we've certainly seen Chris Harris going sideways in places in one.
But that's just going sideways. Can you not go sideways? Can you go sideways 1 degree, 2 degrees, 5 degrees, 10 degrees?
I bet you can.
And then will the car let you fuck up, fix your fuck up without ever biting you? Like that's where the tuning on the Sapphire was so cool, was it just never bit. Mm-hmm. Like if you asked it, it's going to do it. But if you fucked up and it knows you asked for something that you didn't want, you have 50 new ways to correct it, mm-hmm. Which is not normal. I'm very excited. I don't want a 5,500 pound track car, but my God, I would have tracked that car until the end of time. So
be a fun thing to show up at a track day with.
Yeah. Or an autocross.
Yeah. Interesting.
Hey, Lucid.
You need a long-term test.
Yeah, I'll take a
to do that versus the Miata. Just one, the Miata versus the Lucid, and just do everything you would ever do as an enthusiast with a Miata, but do it with a Lucid instead.
Yeah,
including spec racing.
That'd be awesome. The tire bill. Think of the tire bill.
Hello, Lucid and Michelin.
Michelin. Okay, that is my rant on handling for this, the 119th episode of the Carmudgeon Show.
Thank you for joining us. We will see you at some future date, or not see you if you are listening, since a lot of our people are listeners instead of watchers.
Well, then they can't see the stupid faces I'm making, and they probably don't realize that I'm looking very concerned because we were probably supposed to have talked about our Socko car show.
We didn't announce a location for
it. We haven't found a location for it. We'll do that on social media. Sorry. Yes. We're procrastinators.
Oopsies.
Yeah. I'm going to continue to sink into this chair.
Okay. Bye. Do you want me to join you in solidarity?
We're fine. Mom.